Good morning. Whether you're joining us here at 6635 Holman Avenue or you're joining us virtually, wherever you are, my name is Chris. I'm the pastor here at First United Methodist Church, and I am so glad that you are here with us this morning. Let me give you just a couple of tidbits of information. If you're joining us either virtually or in person, we'd ask that you'd fill out our digital registration card. You can do that by going to our website, hammondfumc.org. There you will find a link to our digital registration card. Among other things, you can also help support the ministry of First UMC through the Tithely platform, hitting the donate button there as well. That's hammondfumc.org. And when you do sign our digital registration card, that can put you on our mailing list where you will receive at least a PDF version of our bulletin each week. So if you're joining us virtually and have that PDF or you have the physical one in front of you, let me invite you to look at the back page, the announcements and community events. You'll see the September 2nd mile giving is the Haven House. I'll let you look at that. If you're giving that, we ask that you give generously during our second mile giving for September here. Prayer concerns, I will have you note those as we get later on in the service. And you have a joy or concern to share. We're changing things up a bit. We have our prayer cards back in the pews. If you have a prayer request to be filled out, fill that out throughout the service, and you can bring that up and set that on the altar, and we will make sure to get those read at the proper time. We also want to make special note and ask you to lift up in a very special way the families of both Bill McCoy and Jim Mowry, whom we laid to rest this week and are eternally grateful for their continued legacy in our lives and all they meant to us here at First UMC. We want to ask you to continue to lift their families up in your prayers. I'll have you look through the rest of the week's schedule, and with that, we'll begin our time of worship. And we do that each week with a quick call and response that we repeat three times, where I say, "O Lord, open our lips," and you respond, and we shall declare your praise. Are you ready? Stand with me and join me as we do this. O Lord, open our lips, and we shall declare your praise. O Lord, open our lips, and we shall declare your praise. O Lord, open our lips, and we shall declare your praise. Now join me in singing hymn number 365, Grace Greater Than Our Sin. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. The opening prayer this morning. Just God, you are even-handed. You are even-handed in your justice, and in the day of judgment will not play favorites. We confess that we are not so fair in our dealings. We are often unduly impressed by the powerful and the clever, and excuse in them what we would condemn in the powerless and ignorant. Forgive superficiality and neglect of people needing advocacy and friendship through the friend of the sinners, Jesus Christ. Amen.
You may be seated.
Yes, who the sun sets free, he is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Well, we just need a musical intro. Yay. Hello, I see over here we got John. Hello, Ellison. Hello, John. I see over here we got a few friends. We haven't met yet, but hello, hello, hello. I think that's everyone. Want to remind you, we have that event on October 9th. At Sandridge Nature Center. So anybody planning on going, let me know so I can let them know. This is actually happening during an event that they're already having for the public, but they are making special arrangements for us. So it would be awesome to see a lot of you there, October 9th, noon. So when we first came back live, I think my first time doing a children's time here, I did one called The Social Influencer. And I got to talk about JoJo Siwa in that. Does anybody remember who I said was one of the bigger social influencers from when I was younger? You remember? Okay, I'll take the hand signals. Fonzie, Arthur Fonzarelli from the TV show Happy Days. Now, does anybody remember why I claimed that I made my case? I said, why I think he's one of the bigger social influencers. Does anybody remember that one? No. Okay, that's fine. Often on the show, when somebody didn't know who he was, they would walk up to him and say, are you Arthur Fonzarelli? And he would answer back, that's what it says on my library card. And because of that, more Americans was going to the library to get library cards than like any other time in the history, all because Arthur Fonzarelli, he, the Fonz, had a library card. Do you have a library card, you in the red? Yeah. You have a library card? How about you, the boy next? You got a library card? Donna, I assume you have one too. That's awesome. But if you don't already have one, you should get one. One of the great things about a library card is that it is there for everyone. It doesn't matter if you are young or old. It doesn't matter if you are a boy or a girl. It doesn't matter what you look like. It doesn't matter where you were born or even who your parents are. Everyone is welcome. Another great thing about the library is that once you become a member, you get everything that the library has. You can check out books and videos. You can go to the library and read magazines and newspapers. You can even use the computer. Oh, and how much does it cost to join the library? Anybody know? Oh, everybody knew that answer. All right. Yes, it's totally free. And you know, that is a pretty good picture of what it is like to be a member of the family of God. The Bible tells us that when we trust in Jesus and are united with him in baptism, we all become the children of God. The Bible also tells us that when you belong to the family through Christ Jesus, you are entitled to all the benefits of being called a child of God. All of the promises that God has made in his word belong to you. Isn't that great? Now that brings us to our memory verse for September. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. That is the English Standard Version translation, by the way. And by the way, do you know how much it costs to become a part of the family of God? Nothing. It's a gift of God. Let's pray. Dear Father, we are thankful that we can become your children through faith in Jesus Christ. We are thankful that it doesn't matter whether we are a girl or a boy. We are thankful that in Christ, we all become one. And all of God's children say.
Thank you so much, Mike. And honestly, don't feel bad. By tomorrow afternoon, no one will remember what I have said this morning. So I don't want to cast aspersions. Let me invite you to stand as we continue our time of worship as we sing from The Faith We Sing, number 2176, Make Me a Servant. And we will, join me as we sing. Sorry.
Servant, humble and meek, Lord, let me lift up those who are weak, and may the prayer of my heart always be, make me a servant, make me a servant, make me a servant today. A servant, humble and meek, Lord, let me lift up those who are weak, and may the prayer of my heart always be, make me a servant, make me a servant, make me a servant today.
Be seated. As I mentioned before, whether you're joining us in person or online, we like to be in prayer with you at all times. If you are joining us via Facebook or Zoom, we encourage you as we enter into this time of prayer to use the comment section to help us to keep in prayer with you in these times. Also, let me invite you to join me in looking at the back of the bulletin for the joys and concerns. Of course, continue to lift the family of Bill McCoy and Jim Mowry in our prayers. We want to remember folks such as Shirley Farmer and Don and Joanne Harris and Mary Hinshaw and Sherry Javalekis, Sandy Kisman, Nancy and Jerry Kolonowski, Champ Merrick, Helen O'Mara and Logan Polich, Jane Schauer, Amanda Cerna, Henry and Pat Showers, Nancy and John Steele, Ella Tiedeman and Emily Tiedeman, who Ella is got some sort of stomach bug that I hear is going around schools now that everyone's coming back together. And Emily is, we're hoping, just tired and not coming down with COVID herself. That's why they're not here this morning. Cheryl Walters, and also our homebound Wayne Barnes, Liz Berg, Adele Goyers, Martha Jones, Fran Miklos. And as you have joys and concerns, please fill out those cards and you can put those on the altar and we will be in prayer with you. In this time, let me invite you to quiet your minds and hearts and go with me before God in prayer. God of all work, who created for 6 days and rested on the seventh, bless all who work to create things of beauty and things of utility from the elements that you made from nothing. Divine Redeemer, direct and teach all who repair and renew what has been broken and what no longer works as it should. Bless those who care for people who cannot care for themselves. Healing Spirit, inspire with loving wisdom those who counsel any who have lost their way and are seeking new direction and are having trouble getting it all together. Head of the church, So enable your body to respond with fidelity to all that you command, that your work may proceed with little interruption, and the goals you have set be achieved in our community and our world, which is really yours. Governor of governors, bring a fuller measure of justice to our world, that the rights of all may be protected from childhood to old age, from the simplest worker to the most responsible manager, male and female, all created in your image. Free us from any activity that is a detriment to ourselves and to others. Grant us all joy in our work, that we may have satisfaction in knowing that what we do makes a difference for good, benefiting our common life. God, our Creator, you have created people who go out of their way and to their labor and to labor until evening. We rejoice in both our vocation and our rest. The rest at the end of the day is sweeter after a day of good work. The retirement at the end of years is satisfying when we can look back at what our work has helped to accomplish. We celebrate the rest you have prepared for the people of God. We rejoice in the memory of those who rest from their labor, and their good works follow them to heaven by your gracious acceptance in Jesus Christ. May we not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give. So by your earthly sacraments, prepare us for the heavenly rest through Jesus Christ, who finished his work, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all glory and praise, time without end. Now we ask that you be with us as we pray that prayer Jesus taught us, as he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
The Bible reading for today is from Proverbs 22, verses 1 through 28, or 1 through 2, 8 through 9, and 22 through 23. Chapter 22, verses 1 through 2. A good reputation is better than much wealth. High esteem is better than silver and gold. The rich and the poor have this in common: the Lord made them both. Verses 8 and 9. Those who sow injustice will harvest evil. The rod of their fury will come to an end. Happy are generous people, because they give some of their food to the poor. And verses 22 through 23. Don't steal from the poor because they are poor. Don't oppress the needy in the gate. The Lord will take up their case and press the life out of those who oppress them. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So happy Labor Day, for whatever that means. I honestly don't know if I could get one single answer from any one of us gathered here today. For most of us, mainly it means that tomorrow we get the day off work. But Labor Day comes from a long tradition of those who get their hands dirty for a living, coming together and working to make their conditions better. And so we commemorate that. And it's sort of interesting to think about how the church looks at a day like this and how the church can and should speak into something like this. It's certainly, you know, that the idea of Labor Day, especially over the last couple of years, has taken on a bit of a new meaning for a lot of different people. We've learned phrases such as essential workers and the myriad of job titles that encompasses and how important each and every one of them are. So what do we say on Labor Day as the church to so many people around us? Unfortunately, the world in which we live now, late stage American capitalism, as you will, has sort of upended our desire to root for this group of people, to root for the little guy. Now, I'm not saying that we don't like to root for the little guy in movies and things or in sporting events. That's certainly one thing. I'm saying we've begun to almost devalue the little guy, give power to a few big guys and tolerate their attempts to rip us apart. We've heard a lot about the term tribalism and what that means. Tribalism isn't us sorting ourselves into groups all on our own. It's the big guys going ahead and building encampments for us to sort ourselves into nicely based on the information they're feeding us here and there. And we've sort of allowed it to happen. And we do it all because we've all been raised to believe that we're all just one good idea away from being one of those big guys. When there is little to no evidence that, wow, that it might actually happen. It can happen still. In a very few cases, still more of us will have to work every day getting our hands dirty. Now, not only are we devaluing the little guy, but we're scapegoating all of the little guys around us in the process. Afghan refugees are future partisan voters to some that will make our country more violent and browner. There is the cravenness of the demonization of refugees traveling in caravans to this country from countries we've destabilized long ago. We demonize burger flippers because we've been trained to believe that they don't need a livable wage. How dare they, right? How much do you want to flip burgers? I don't know. How about enough that when I am at work, I don't have to worry about whether or not I will have food or a house by the end of the week, and then maybe I would be able to smile more when I hand Happy Meals out to customers who may have been less than nice to me. It's all tied up in this idea from the first part of our passage today, reputation. Who's got it? Who doesn't? Where does ours get us? And it's very important for us as Christians to understand this. We have been trained in very many ways to do the opposite of that which we are called to by our Savior. See, unfortunately, we've been taught that we've been sold on a certain reputation, a reputation that we can buy. And if we buy enough of it, we'll achieve that certain reputation. And more recently, we've had to worry about our personal reputations due to a phenomenon known as cancel culture. You've heard that term being used. The term given mainly to online efforts to express displeasure with one's actions or beliefs. That's much more complicated than that, but that's a very brief overview. Now, some view it as the height of silencing free speech. There's an argument to make for that, though it's in the free market of ideas. If your idea is not gaining traction, maybe it's a problem. Or maybe it might be good to ask if I was canceled for my beliefs, or maybe I was just being a jerk. I know in some cases I'm the latter. The Christian should not be concerned with being canceled. Too many of us are, unfortunately. But we should not be concerned with being canceled, right? We will learn Jesus didn't care about it. We know Jesus didn't care about it. And Jesus may have been the ultimate cancellation in more ways than one. We will learn that we need to order our lives in a little different fashion than worrying about whether or not we will be canceled or our reputation or achieving a reputation we've been told is worth it. Our reputation isn't the important thing in our faith equation. But back to our passage for this morning. First, the passage is a selection of verses from throughout the chapter. Now, you might be saying to yourself, self, didn't Pastor Chris recently speak of the problems of selecting certain verses to say something that you want to say that it might not say? Well, to that I say, I did. But this is more building on a principle and discovering various layers to our holy text. It's essentially do as I say, not as I do. No, but it not actually. This is a lectionary text, and it represents a sort of cliff notes of the broader chapter. It's very nice to hear scripture read in church, but we have people who have put together messages, not talking about only myself included, but this is a whole experience. Please, I encourage you to read your Bible outside of this space. Right now, we're getting the cliff notes, and right now, this is an important message the church needs to hear. It covers a couple of different things. First, reputation is separate than wealth, a concept that is lost in capitalism. Right? It's the big guy who has the good reputation, and it's the small guy who has the bad reputation. Just ask those who have to avail themselves of the criminal justice system. Second, a godly reputation consists of that which is in your heart and actions and not in your bank accounts. Thirdly, if you are terrible to those whose bank accounts are smaller than yours through their efforts or through the efforts of those who do evil on them, God tends to deal with you a little harshly. And so it behooves us to work this out for ourselves. Right? That indicates a different kind of standard for the Christian. And that standard was given to us in the person of Jesus Christ. His example shows us just exactly what reputation means. Not only did Jesus choose to dine with sinners, commune with those who others would turn away, he also spoke to those who we would give that reputation automatically, to the big guy, saying, it's not impossible for you to get into the kingdom of heaven, but it's pretty difficult. This Jesus has a very interesting idea of what reputation means. Because Jesus wasn't concerned with his reputation amongst humanity, but before God. Indicative of that, he was often seen with those of ill repute. And that was his point, really. Zacchaeus, Mary Magdalene, those who no one would touch. That's the point. That's the point. Now, I have my disagreements with Pope Francis, but he said this, and it is so spot on. It speaks to this reputation the church has gotten over time, that we're sort of hands off, and that we have really just let our own problems get in our way of doing the thing that the founder of our faith so long ago told us to do. But he says this: I prefer a church which is bruised, hurting, and dirty because it has been out on the streets, rather than a church which is unhealthy from being confined and from clinging to its own security. I do not want a church concerned with being at the center and then ends up by being caught up in a web of obsessions and procedures. Jesus said it was very difficult for those who had to get into heaven. Not impossible, but difficult. He also didn't worry about his reputation. And on Labor Day, I think that says something to the church, at least about the least amongst us, those whom Jesus would view as the least amongst us, and with whom we seek to align ourselves. the oppressor or the one who brings the oppressor to justice. I know whose side I'd rather be on. I know I've been on one side or the other at various points in my life, but each Christian is to work out their own faith with what? Fear and trembling. Where are you in that equation? Where does your heart need to be or to be moved? Today is the first Sunday of the month. It's our communion Sunday, and Jesus invites us to the table to examine just that, to examine our hearts in any fashion we may need. Maybe it's this fashion, maybe it's another. But Jesus invites us to this table to consider how best we live this life, how best we seek justice and sit with those who await it and those who labor. Let us meet him there now. Amen. Now let me invite you to stand as you are comfortable as we sing our communion hymn number 393, Spirit of the Living God. And we'll sing this through two times. If you do need communion elements, raise your hand and we'll have an usher bring those around to you. If you're joining us virtually and you haven't yet prepared your elements, you still have a couple of moments. You can grab, if you happen to have baked a loaf of bread recently, you can grab that and some grape juice. If you haven't, thank you very much. Okay, sorry, I'm getting a little confused here this morning. If you haven't got the bread or wine or grape juice on hand, you can certainly grab a donut or coffee or anything, because we believe through the power of the Holy Spirit that God can transform anything, and that includes the elements that we use to celebrate the Lord's Supper. And we also celebrate an open table, meaning that you do not have to have a prior relationship with Christ. You do not have to be a member of a church yet. You just have to come forward with a heart desiring to reach out to God and to receive that which God offers us here at this table. The table of bread is now to be made ready. It is the table of company with Jesus and all who love him. It is the table of sharing with the poor of the world with whom Jesus identified himself. It is the table of communion with the earth in which Christ became incarnate. So come to this table, you who have much faith and you who would like to have more. You who have been here often and you who have not been for a long time. You who have tried to follow Jesus and you who have failed. You who have sinned and seek forgiveness, come. It is Christ who invites us to meet him here. Let us pray. Loving God, through your goodness, we have this bread and wine to offer, which has come forth from the earth and human hands have made. May we know your presence in the sharing so that we may know your touch and presence in all things. We celebrate the life that Jesus has shared among his community through the centuries and shares with us now. Made one in Christ and one with each other, we offer these gifts and with them ourselves a single living act of praise. Amen. The body of Christ broken for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Now let me invite you to stand as we join together in our closing hymn. Oh, no, excuse me. Sorry, folks. In this time, let me invite the ushers to come forward as we give of ourselves and our gifts to God. Once more, if you are joining us virtually and you would like to, or you're joining us in person and would like to support the ministry of First-UMC of Hammond, you can go to our website, hammondfumc.org, follow the donate button to the Tithely platform, and you can follow the instructions there. Now let me invite once again the ushers to come forward as we give of ourselves and our gifts to God.
Change my heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me, this is what I pray. Change my heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. Change my heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you.
Join me in prayer. Accept, O Lord, these offerings your people make unto you, and grant that the work to which they are devoted may prosper under your guidance, all to the glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now let me invite you to remain standing as you're comfortable and join us as we sing Hold Us Together.
You don't have a job, don't pay your bills, won't buy you a home in Beverly Hills. Don't fix your life in five easy. steps in the law of the land, government. But it's all you need, and love will hold us together, make us a shelter. Knocking at your door in the moment of truth, harness the Lord, and you're on your knees. Love will hold us together, make us a shelter.
Thank you so much for joining us today. As you leave this place this day, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you all and give you peace. Amen.